cracking with our next session now. So up next, we have Josh Simmons here. Josh is a director on the Open Source Initiative, and he's part of Google's open source projects. He is going to be talking about how you can do community building when you're out beyond the black stump, which is great because, well, I'm not in SF, so hand it over to Josh. Oh, sorry, you got the
yes. Hello, and thank you for being here. As Tim here mentioned, my name is Josh Simmons. I am a web developer, I'm a marketer, and I'm an accidental community organizer. I am also part of the Open Source Programs Office outreach team at Google, and yes, with the Open Source Initiative. So today I'm talking about how to build communities when you don't live in Sydney or San Francisco. Much of the information that's out there is about how to build communities when you're in a Silicon Valley or a metropolis or that kind of setting. Now, the reality is, I believe it was 2014 when the UN report came out that 46% of people live in rural or they don't live in cities, basically. So there's a whole world of people out there that we're not serving by talking specifically about building communities with the assumption that they live in these cities. So what I'm going to do is tell you the story of WIMP. WIMP is a community that I co-founded in 2011. And I'm gonna highlight all of the little things along the way that we did that either they were the right choices that we made or they were happy accidents that we learned later were really critical to building community. But first, a little housekeeping. I have planned for 5 minutes of questions at the end. So please write them down as they come up. We'll see how many questions we get to. If you have questions that we don't answer or that come to mind later, you'll find me around the conference. You can find my Twitter handle somewhere on that slide, and I'm always happy to chat. All right. Also, disclaimer, I have worn many, many hats, and I still wear quite a few. Right now, I'm wearing the hat of the individual, Joshua Simmons, accidental community organizer. Nothing I say represents in any way my current, former, future employers. And lastly, my slides will not be available. Don't worry, you're not missing out. They're just visual aid for the talk. So before we dive in, I want to highlight all of the key ingredients of meetups and building meet space communities. There are countless resources covering all of these things, so I'm not going to cover them directly. But now that you've seen these, my hope is that you'll have a mental model to work with as I share my story. So, it was 2011, and I had been working as a web developer for 9 years. I had started to get more and larger clients to the point that I couldn't keep up. I could no longer expand my business, and so I needed to subcontract to people. Challenge was is that I didn't know anybody to subcontract to. I had a few friends who were into computers, and maybe they were working in restaurants or grocery stores, whatever, and they were interested in transitioning to some longer-term career. So I took a few friends, and I actually trained them up as junior developers, and they were able to help me expand the business a little bit. But suffice it to say, that tactic does not scale very well. What I needed were people who were already experienced professionals. Yes, junior developers were really critical, but I needed another senior developer, someone who could take the lead on things. At some point, I ended up researching local competitors. And I defined competitors in the broadest possible terms. I looked at other developers, designers, and marketers. And in the process, I discovered a local designer named Melissa Geisinger. So I reached out to Melissa. Her and I were both about the same age, and both trying. It was clear we were both trying to expand our business. So we met for coffee one day, and we hit it off as friends and as very, very frustrated professionals. So we met on April 7th, 2011, and later that night, I created a group on Facebook and on Meetup. We were the North Bay Web Professionals, a group for both designers and developers. Now, I want to be clear, it's not that there were not communities in Sonoma County. There was the North Bay Internet Society that was for local entrepreneurs, of which there were a few. There was a LUG, and there were Pearl Mongers. But those groups had either dwindled or were not serving the needs that we needed. Often they really catered to hobbyists who enjoyed the technology but weren't necessarily working in the industry. So herein, we found our first lesson. When you're building a community outside of Metropolis, multidisciplinary communities can be a tactic for getting the critical mass you need to actually build something that's sustainable. Without a critical mass, it's too easy for a community to falter when the organizer burns out or is otherwise incapacitated or indisposed. And critical mass and momentum makes the group more interesting to other prospective new members. They help you distribute the burden of organizing. But multidisciplinary communities, it's not just a solution to the challenge of building professional communities in areas with low population density. There are great benefits, too. For instance, these communities actually produce more opportunities. Think about it. If you're working as a developer, chances are you're going to need to hire a designer on more projects than you'll need to hire a developer. Or if you're a marketer, you're going to need to hire developers and designers to get your projects done and delivered. You may not really need to hire other marketers. So by having a community of professionals who had mutual interests but different skill sets, a lot of people were hiring each other and subcontracting to each other. We surveyed, and it was really incredible the amount of work that people got out of the community. Lastly, multidisciplinary communities are more welcoming. When you have a community that is all, say, JavaScript developers, well, there are, let's just put it this way. When you have a multidisciplinary community, no one is ever the smartest person in the room. You end up with less blowhards, less braggarts, less just really tense conversations where people are trying to one-up each other and prove their skills. This was a place where everybody was valuable, everybody had something to learn from each other, and so there was none of this, there were fewer of the toxic dynamics that you might see in professional communities. And lastly, this made it a place where people continued to be curious and engaged. This was a safe space for beginners, whether they were students or people working on their second or third career. A lot of print designers, for instance, would join the group as they were trying to learn how to do web design. So there are many benefits to multidisciplinary communities on top of being very important for building the critical mass that you need when there is low population density. So we had, we were founded on April 7th. We hosted our first meetup 20 days later. It was an informal event to get people interested, to figure out what they wanted and what they needed. We also were hoping to find other co-organizers and find presenters for the first meetups to follow that. So we had 23 people at our inaugural event, including people we hadn't considered. I mentioned that we started the group as the North Bay Web Professionals for designers and developers. Well, we also found that marketers and writers began attending. So I want to zoom in on something here, a couple of different lessons. First, how do you go from two, me and Melissa, you know, your organizers, to 23, the people who actually come to that first event? And I also want to talk a little bit about adapting to the needs of your community. Going from 2 to 23, requires elbow grease and some luck. I'm not gonna lie, it's not an easy thing to do. We did get lucky. But there are things that you can do to improve your odds of having a successful first event. We told everyone that we knew, even people who weren't working in the industry or necessarily interested in attending themselves, because they will either know people who are interested or they will meet people along the way and they'll refer them to you. Find your competitors. Let them know that you're putting on this event. The reality is that all ships rise with the tide. They're going to be able to improve their skills as well as find more people to hire to expand their business. Are there marketing agencies, development shops, IT repair shops in the area? They tend to have a lot to gain from multidisciplinary communities because they can hire from them, and there's also a lot of business that they'll get from them. Inform them, invite them, and encourage them to pass it on to the people that they work with. Often there's a whole network of subcontractors that will work around these companies that they can get the word out to. Another tactic is reaching out to vocational schools and universities in the area. Let their career guidance counselors know. Let their professors know. Find the relevant departments, deans, clubs, etc. There are many ways to approach schools, and professors and career guidance counselors will jump at the opportunity to connect their students with professionals working in the industry and increase their odds of getting jobs. Are there co-working spaces in the area? Or maybe there are cafes or restaurants or pubs in the area that people often go to and sort of co-work. And, you know, freelancers often will work from home or they'll go to places like that to get their work done. These are watering holes that you can tap into, and, you know, maybe it's something as simple as a flyer. Maybe they have a mailing list. You can encourage them to get the word out. And really, here's a big one. Are there other meetup groups? Are there other user groups? There probably are. You know, I found in Sonoma County that there were groups for hiking, there were groups for all manner of other interests that we were able to talk to those organizers and say, hey, you obviously have a community, you know, we're a different kind of community, but would you be willing to share us with your members? And you'll often be able to get some people to show up from that. You can also partner with those other groups to host events. Now that's more relevant if they're like-minded event groups, and I'll get to that later. So I mentioned earlier that I also wanted to talk about adapting to the needs of your community. You may have a vision of what you want to build and what's needed, and that's good. You know, a leader without a vision is going to have a hard time persuading anyone to show up. But you also must tune in to the people who actually show up and what they need. What we found is that we weren't just surprised by marketers and writers showing up. We had photographers, we had videographers, we had audio producers. We had all manner of people who had a hand in working with digital media, software, and web development, and we all had something to gain from each other. So look at who shows up, listen to them, and adapt as best you can to serve the broadest possible community. Now, you can never make everyone happy. We know that. But you can often find a common thread through all of these people who show up so that you can serve a broad audience. So, we had this first meetup, and that meetup, the inaugural meetup, was ridiculously low-key. I had been renting like a little cubicle in a local marketing agency's office, and they were happy to let us use the office after hours to host our first event. We encouraged everyone to bring food and drink to share. We never turned anyone away for their inability to contribute. And Melissa and I seeded the potluck with basics, paper towels, plates, cutlery, etc. We set the start time for 7 p.m. and planned to go to 8:30. Knowing that people are always late, especially when you're new and they see attending your event as an extracurricular rather than an important part of doing their job, we actually got started at 7:15, and we allowed time for people just to mingle. This also allowed us to greet people as they showed up. So come 7:15, We made a big circle with chairs and anything that people could sit on, and we asked everybody to take a seat. Melissa and I introduced ourselves. We shared what kind of vision we had, what kind of community we were trying to build, and why. And we enumerated the specific things that we hoped to achieve that night specifically. So then something unremarkable happened, but something that ended up being very important. We went around the room and we asked people to introduce themselves. Now, we wanted them to share their name and their skill set, just so we knew what kind of, you know, what people were interested in, and so that we could serve them. But this round of introductions became meaningful for a lot of reasons, and it ended up being a tradition that we did at every event. We did intros even when we had 50 people attending an event. Now, that said, we tried to keep people short, like, you know, give us your 30-second elevator pitch, move on. Why is this meaningful? This meant that people were more easily able to remember names. You know, we're at a conference here. How many times have you forgotten someone's name already? It's really useful to have badges or to be reminded of people's names to smooth out those awkward moments. And it helped identify people that folks might want to work with or talk to later. And perhaps most importantly, this allowed newcomers to introduce themselves to the group. And suddenly, even the wallflowers, even the introverts of the group, would be pulled out of their shell just a little bit, and they would be known, and then people would approach them later. They'd have useful, productive conversations. It put people in a social mindset, and it worked to counterbalance the inevitable cliques that we see form in any community. So suddenly, we have professionals who aren't just showing up doing an extracurricular to improve their work. They're an individual among peers, and everybody is seeking to learn and find opportunity. This created a sense of belonging and relevance for the group that kept people coming back. So after we did introductions, we facilitated a few important discussions. We time-boxed each of those discussions. That is to say, we set a time limit and made sure that we stuck to it, because conversations can go on forever if we let them. We talked about what days and times worked best for people. You know, when were they available? Evenings, weekends, weekdays, etc. We brainstormed the topics that people were interested in learning about and sharing. And we invited people to step up if they wanted to help organize or volunteer at the at other events. So with these three things, the days and times that worked for people, topics, and people who were willing to help run the group, we had a framework. We used this framework to then pick the date and time of our next meetup. We selected our first topic based on who was available and who was willing to share. And we set a date before the next event for people who are interested in volunteering and organizing to get together to figure out other details. Melissa and I thanked people profusely. We made sure that we connected with every single person who attended, made sure that they had the URL for both the Facebook group and the meetup page. And this actually brings me to another point. And here we are at a FOSS conference, and I think that there's a shared interest in living our values by using FOSS non-proprietary tools. Now, this was not a group that was formed around shared values in that way. This was a professional group with pragmatic take and goals in mind. That said, there are still people who really would rather not use Facebook. But we used Facebook. We used Facebook because people use Facebook. They go there every day. They get the notifications. They respond to the notifications. And it was just in front of their face. It wasn't a different place that they had to go to engage with the community. And we use Meetup. We use Meetup, which is fantastic for cross-promoting to other people. You know, it's a decent event management platform. It has forums and discussion features. Those are kind of anemic and not really worth using. But because people were already on Meetup, because Meetup does a great job of cross-promoting events to people who have certain interests, it ends up being a really effective tool for getting people to show up. Yes, it sends a lot of email, but email works. We found in the long run that a full third of our membership came just from meetup promoting to people who are on the platform. And when I say a third of our membership, the group now has about 635 people on meetup. So that's not an insignificant number of people. So 6 years later, the discussion of migrating to an open source platform or platforms that are perhaps more respectful of user privacy still bubble up. They come up regularly. I think we probably all see this in our communities. But though we would like to go in that direction, the reality is this is a volunteer-run group. Most of the communities that we run in are also volunteer-run. And there is rarely the time and bandwidth to build out new tooling or to connect all of the platforms. I have to commend LCA. There are a couple of volunteers who managed to connect IRC, Slack, and Matrix, which is incredible, so that people have options. The bottom line is here is using the right tools for the job. Go where people already are. Let's try not to be too purist in our choices when we're working, when we're swimming upstream already and building community. So getting back to the inaugural event, we ended up going late, which, like our introductions, also became a tradition. We finished our discussion on time, but people wanted more time to mingle. And this repeated itself often enough that we eventually settled on a format that was a little social time up front, some sort of topic in the middle, whether that was a presentation or a discussion, and then a social hour afterwards. Most of our events, most of these events went from 7 to 10 p.m. So that's how we got our start. Later, we would have photographers, I mentioned videographers, sysadmins, and more types of professionals join us. We found the common thread and we redefined ourselves. We renamed ourselves from the North Bay Web Professionals to the Web and Interactive Media Professionals, thus WIMP. Just think about the acronyms, first of all. Try to pronounce NIBWIP, WIMP. One of those is gonna be more memorable. And this, you see on the screen, became our slogan. Yes, there are answers out there online. There's knowledge to be found. But often we don't even know how to ask the right questions, or we don't even know what we need to learn. And so by going into a community of people with different skill sets, you'll be able to ask the questions as best as you can, and someone there is going to understand what you're asking. You're going to be able to learn the things that you need to learn, and ultimately it sets an atmosphere, a tone for a community that's just really, really welcoming. There are questions that got asked over and over again in person and on our forums. We did not link to the old posts most of the time. We didn't say RTFM. We didn't say that's kind of a dumb question. No. This was a space for everybody. Everybody had something to learn from each other. And so it was a welcoming place, and it just kept people coming back. Now, we quickly began hosting many types of events. Since then, the group has hosted over 179 events. It's grown to 635 members on Meetup, over 1,100 on Facebook. Interestingly, we ended up with people all over the world joining our Facebook group because it was, again, a multidisciplinary community. We could share things. It was a very different atmosphere from other professional communities and much more accessible. Now, we may have held 179 events, but the core was always the monthly topical meetup that we started right at the beginning. Whether we had a speaker, a panel, or discussion group, it was some topic and we rotated through topics. Now, programming events, choosing the topics, was non-trivial. We had to vary topics so that everyone was served, whether they were a designer, developer, or some other strange bird. So how did we do that? It helped that we had an organizing team that was as diverse as the community we were serving. I was a developer and marketer. Melissa was a designer. We had a podcaster and an IT person all joined the organizing group. And ultimately, this proved a bit of a challenge in terms of finding speakers who were able to provide content that served the whole audience. What we did is we would come up as organizers with topics, And yes, we would poll the group for topics as well. And then we would talk about how we could look at that topic through different lenses. For instance, we had an event about Photoshop. Yes, that was catered to designers, but it was about how to use Photoshop in terms of building websites. We talked about the temptation to build a design, toss it over a wall to developer, and hope for a pixel-perfect design. We talked about tactics like style tiles and wireframes that lent themselves to the craft of building websites. And lastly, we discussed how designers and developers can talk to each other to get the best possible results. That resulted in an event that was useful to basically everyone. Now, yes, when we had a design-oriented topic, we had a mostly design audience, but the way we approached this allowed people to come knowing that they were still going to learn something valuable. Now, this, of course, presents another challenge. How do you get speakers who can do this? And the answer is that we generally didn't. We would get speakers, and we would give them as much guidance as we could. We would allow them to focus on what they were comfortable speaking on. And then we would just have a Q&A that we facilitated. We as organizers would already have questions in mind and things that we wanted to cover, and we would seed the Q&A. And that would always be a very productive time. This begs the question, how do you get speakers at all? Well, getting speakers is difficult. And the truth is that you as an organizer should probably be prepared to step in as a presenter, as I did a few times, or a discussion facilitator. Ideally, you'll have some topics in your back pocket. To recruit speakers, we constantly put out calls. We included the topics we were looking for, and we provided a lot of support and encouragement. A lot of people speak, their first speaking engagement is at a meetup. And so getting someone to go from 0 to 20, is that first jump is really intimidating. People are deathly afraid of speaking. So we would reassure them. We would highlight the benefits of speaking. And the reality is that because we were a welcoming community, there was never the smartest person in the room, et cetera. It was a safer place for people to get started. People were comfortable doing that. So one thing that I want to touch on that we really strove for was creating a sense of belonging for our group. When you're hosting a meetup in San Francisco or Sydney or Melbourne, you've got a deep well of potential members, and you might think of them as attendees rather than members. You're less concerned that they're going to stick around because you know there are always enough people to keep the event going. But when you're out in the sticks, you need people to keep coming back. So I mentioned earlier we had held over 179 events. That's an average of 3 events a month. Now, that's a lot of work. How did we do it? We had many different types of events. We had the monthly events that were topical, but we also had lunches. Lunches, we rotated around the county. In fact, we rotated around the entire tri-county region so that eventually we would end up in someone's backyard, and maybe they had heard about us but weren't willing to drive to meet us. So when we were suddenly in their city, they would come. Another thing that was really useful about the lunches is they were super casual. For people who aren't joiners, who aren't confident or really used to going out and joining communities or going to events, meetups and events are black boxes. They have no idea what their experience is going to be like. And so by saying, we're just going to have a lunch, there's no pressure to do anything other than sit down, eat, and talk to who's next to you. So a lot of the members came to our lunches first, both because they were casual and because we rotated them throughout the region. We, of course, had topical meetups that weren't just presentations. Sometimes they were themed. We did client horror stories for one Halloween. And we also started holding unconferences. This was from 2012. And unconferences, like meetups, are a place where people will often speak for the first time. So that was a great opportunity to get more people involved and sort of build a pipeline of speakers for the rest of the year. Now, this is one of the things that we did that is nearest and dearest to my heart. This is a photo from Wimp Gives. Wimp Gives was a charity hackathon. This was inspired by the local community college, wherein people who were working in getting a web-related certificate their capstone course was working with a nonprofit with a team over a semester or two semesters to build a website for that nonprofit. The reality is, nonprofits often have websites that desperately need help. But speaking to the people who helped organize that, the nonprofits were actually a little iffy on that whole thing, because when you've got students, bless their hearts, you're gonna get mixed results. So what we did is we had a community of professionals who were already experienced. And what we did is we paired them together. You see here someone sitting from the nonprofit on the far end, and a team of, I think that's the developer. No, that's the designer, the writer, the designer, and the developer, all in that order. And we also paired them with students. So we have a team of professionals, each with different skills, who could help build this website for a nonprofit. We paired them with students who could be an apprentice, who could learn from the experience and build not only their resume, their portfolio, but also build relationships with people who are already in the industry. There's a big difference between the assignments that you do in school and the actual work of getting things done. And so this was a really valuable experience for students. This brought in also a lot of press and exposure. This became a theme for us, engaging the local community in any way that we possibly could. We got engaged with the nonprofits. We got engaged with the schools. A few of us ended up sitting on the digital media advisory committee for the local two-year college to help make sure their curriculum was up to date and useful. Professors ended up sending their students to us, treating attendance and participation as extra credit. We later got involved with local economic development. I mentioned wine-soaked region. Tourism, beer, wine, and spirits are what Sonoma County and Napa County, the region, are all about. But there's so much more going on there, and really those industries are serving everyone else outside of the region rather than the people who are there. And so we worked with local economic development agencies to garner support for local entrepreneurs and freelancers. And we brought attention to digital media in a region where all the focus was on these other things. You know, often we would find that a local city would put out a RFP for a new website, and the website would get built by a company across the country or in another country, which, good for them, but really our focus was building local talent, building local opportunity. We got involved with one of the major local industries as well, agriculture. We built relationships that led to work for our members, but also to more polished public presence for the sort of one of the crown jewel industries. And we did this by hosting ag tech mixers. No, not about agriculture technology, but agriculture people and technologists. We did this with the local Farmers Guild and Grain Society, and this just got us deeper and deeper and more involved with the community. I mentioned RFPs for local cities. We held brainstorms when there was an RFP going to be put out, because we wanted to make sure that the city was putting out an RFP that would produce the best results for the local citizens. We held paid workshops, gave people hands-on experience and a small revenue stream for experts. We signed up for online conferences and streamed conferences as a group. But for the time zones, we might have been streaming LCA. We had co-working days, which helped get freelancers out of the house and allowed us to bounce ideas off of each other. Anybody who has worked in both a freelance context as well as a larger company context knows that it's really nice to actually be able to turn around and ask a question of your coworker. Your problems get solved much faster that way. Now, in fact, we eventually opened our own clubhouse, the WIMP space, and we had co-working days there. We held events there. We didn't do that for long because we were a volunteer organization. We didn't actually have the funding. We were donation-driven. But we proved the demand was there, and now there are over a half dozen co-working spaces in Sonoma County alone, more than a dozen in the entire region. Now, speaking of money, we always ask for donations. We had a little R2-D2, like, mug that we always, like, ask people to donate to, because meetup charges fees. It cost us as organizers to either rent space or to provide the basics for every potluck. It provided enough to cover our basic expenses. Now, in the end, I found a new passion and a new home, community building. Truth be told is that some point along this journey, I had co-founded a startup, and I had failed it miserably. I had spent more time organizing my community than running my business, which is terrible, and I was fired for it, and that was great. That was like the right thing to do. But what I learned is that my passion was not so much the building of technology, though I love building things. It was people. It was bringing people together and empowering them. So not only did it lead to my firing from my startup, it led to my hiring as a community manager at O'Reilly Media, who is based in Sonoma County. I worked there covering open source and web technology, OSCON and Fluent. And so I began doing community work on another scale, right? This became national, international community organizing and management. So I resigned my post from WIMP in late 2015, and my co-founders did as well in 2016. Now, happily, we had done a good enough job of building a sense of belonging, recruiting volunteers, and creating a sense of ownership, and delegating often enough that by the time we needed to step away, that there were people already experienced enough to take over for us. So that's the story of how we created community where there was none or little. The group continues to thrive, and now there's a watering hole for digital media professionals, and there's a critical mass such that new groups were able to come together. Now there's a Hack Sonoma County. Now there's a North Bay Designers. Hell, there's a Makerspace and Art Collective that sort of shot out of our group as well. And there's even the Professional Services Marketing Group, who you would hope would have a better name, but there it is. So that's all I've got for you. I hope that this talk will help you build the community that you need, till the soil and pave the way for more. And even if you're not in a rural or suburban area, I hope that the notion of multidisciplinary communities takes root, because I think that's what free and open source software needs. I think we need more cross-pollination between designers and developers and writers, et cetera, such that FOSS creates usable software that ultimately extends the promise of free software beyond the geeks to the end users. Thank you. Absolutely. We ended up running a community survey that polled people on the number of job referrals that they would get. We asked them questions like, have you learned things that are critical to your work or have helped you do your work better? There's some sort of qualitative questions that we asked as well. I think attendees is a really good way of measuring growth and exposure, but it's also kind of like measuring retweets or page views, right? Like that's just the beginning of the funnel. So what you wanna do in terms of measuring health is look at what the impacts are. So that could be, you know, what have you learned? How many jobs have you gotten? In fact, I have the survey around somewhere, and if you follow up with me, I'd be happy to share more about that.
You mentioned that your Facebook group ended up collecting a whole pile of people that weren't local. Did you ever do anything to try and include them in anything or in any way focus on them?
Yes and no. There was one point where we realized we had a lot of members in Denver, Colorado, and we attempted to franchise our group. That was a massive failure. Maybe try not doing that. But we did have regular discussions. We still allowed those people who may not have been local to chime in on surveys of what topics we might cover at the events. there were people who lived in different countries that became sort of the resident experts on certain topics. We encouraged everybody to participate, and we never excluded somebody for where they were from. We were never really able to bring them into events, but we eventually got live streaming figured out, and we did get people tuning in that way, which was kind of cool. I think that's probably an area we could have explored more, but that just ended up being an interesting artifact more than anything else.
Hi.
Hi there.
I've recently moved to quite a small town, and so the central message I got from your talk was to build a multidisciplinary community, and I think that's wonderful because, you know, there's not going to be a huge stack of developers we're moving to. The question I have is about, like, how far can you go with that? You talked about having the ag tech meetup, so what was the experience with bringing together people that are from really different worlds, but maybe share some common values, and how can you get those people to maybe see that so that they come along to the meetup and then make that successful as well?
I think the shared value that we were able to emphasize that brought people out of the woodwork for those sort of mixers between different communities was the focus on local. You know, there's a lot of local pride. There's a lot of want to make your community a better place. And then there's, of course, just the self-interest of, well, I want my business or my farm or whatever to be doing better. And so what we found is we didn't go to, like, the farmer's market and, like, flyer. What we did is we actually found people who led the local farmers guild, and they were able to, to bring their people to the table. And I think that can go pretty far. You know, if you can engage with the industries that are already there, especially the industries that are really valued and important, that will help both with exposure for your event, but with creating opportunity. And we found interesting commonalities that ended up going in completely different directions. I think the Ag Tech Mixer is one of the ways that the sort of art space, maker space community shot out of it, because here were all these people who liked building things in one medium or another. So that's something that I think you could go pretty far with. I have one thing I wanted to add that I didn't mention is that we found there were meetups in further flung places, and people would be willing to attend our events because we were closer to them. We would reach out to those meetups that were aligned with what we were doing, and we told them, hey, we've got this thing, we're doing it here. And then people who might have been previously driving an hour or more to get to those events would come to our events. Now, that's maybe kind of a zero-sum game, but most organizers have the interest of their community at heart, and so we're more than happy to pass that along.
Apart from donation, do you have other means of recouping the funding, like membership fees, and how do you handle the running costs, like hiring venues and things like that?
So we ran the occasional crowdfunding campaign. We had donations that we were looking at. We were accepting at every event. We did end up building a small membership program where we would have local vendors offer discounts and things like that. Conveniently, we had O'Reilly Media in our backyard, so we had things that were pretty lucrative to the people who showed up to our event. Membership programs are worth exploring, crowdfunding campaigns. And we were actually able to save a lot of money on venues. And even on food. We found a local sandwich shop that was owned by one of the nonprofits we had built a website for, and they were happy to donate to us, which was lovely. And we were able to find enough marketing agencies and co-working spaces and people, organizations that would get value out of being a gathering place for all of these professionals, such that they would just give us the space for free.
Well, if there's no more questions, please join me in thanking Josh for giving us such a lovely talk.